To see everybody on this wonderful Sunday morning. I am Ashley Rogers. I'm our Children and Youth Education Director here at Wells. Reverend Chris and Reverend Sue are both out of town for family engagements around weddings and celebrations. So we are really excited that they got to do that with their families this weekend. And Dr. Jeff Parker and I are going to hold it down for the week. So yeah, there we go. All right. So to start this morning, just to call your attention to a few announcements. You saw an insert in your bulletin for Tables of Eight. That is such a fun experience. If you have not done it, you get put in a group and sent to a restaurant to just talk and to get to know each other. So you'll see a couple different options for if you're single or a couple wanting to go to the same restaurant or a couple wanting to go to different restaurants. And if you need childcare, we do need to know that as well. So if this is something you'd like to participate in, do fill this out. I would say put it in the offering plate. However, later in the service, you're going to need the other side for our hymn. So if you want to hold on to it and put it in the offering plate at the end of service, that's fine. But just, you know, you might need those lyrics later in the service. You'll see in the back we have our bulletin board for our youth group fundraiser. We're headed to Galveston in just a few weeks, and we are in the midst of our fundraiser. This is the only fundraiser that the youth are doing this year, so we're hoping that they can get lots of support to help make this trip a possibility. We'll be gone for 6 days. Two of those days we'll be in service. Two of those days we'll be having fun. Two of those days we'll be traveling. So please support us with whatever gift that you are able to, and know that we love and appreciate you and your support of our young people. If you don't, let me pull it up. If you don't already have this awesome app called Instant Church Directory, I highly suggest you get it. It's awesome. It allows you to see anybody at church at the drop of a hat. And trust me, there have been many times in Kroger where I have seen someone on aisle 2, and by the time I see them on aisle 6, I'm able to say, "Hey, Ann, how are you?" Because that's cool. Not so much anymore, but if you know. So I would love for you to download this. And if you are not in the app, we would love to add you, and it's so easy. You just submit a picture of yourself or of your family. You tell us the month and day of your birthday, the contact information you'd like us to have for you. It is so, so simple. We do like to remind people that as your family changes, you can change the picture. So just the other day, I finally added my son to the app, and since we're now a bigger family, so it's really neat. It's flexible. The changes are instantaneous, so as your life changes or adapts or your contact information changes, we can get that up to date in the app, and you don't have to worry about digging out the old paper one with the photos. And so let us help you get on the app. In 2 Sundays we're doing Senior Sunday, so if you have someone matriculating in your life, let me know, so that way I can make sure that we have a little happy for them and that they're included in the bulletin. And for our families of graduates, I will be reaching out. I'll talk to the graduate first, and then I'm going to talk to Mama to get a little biographical blurb. So if you don't want your Mama bragging on you with whatever she's going to tell me, answer me when I ask you. And then our Pentecost picnic, you'll be surprised. Our Pentecost picnic is Sunday, May 28th. We'll have service outdoors at 10 o'clock. We'll be joining with Broadmeadow United Methodist Church. And then we'll have dinner on the grounds. We'll have the bounce house. It'll be tons of fun. Bring a fan. Dress comfy and for warm weather. We'll have a blast. And then next Saturday is our Habitat for Humanity build. I know Sue had been saying we need some muscle because we're going to be doing trusses. They're not there yet. So we're going to be hanging walls. So a little less muscle is required. But patience and being able to look at a level and things like that. So it's a little bit different than what we had thought. But if you can help with that, let Sue know and we will add you to the list. Any announcements I forgot? Anything pertinent? Great. All right, birthdays and anniversaries. Here are the ones that I know about thanks to the app. This week, celebrating a birthday, David Moody, Peggy Smith, Bill Johnson, Gene Rosman, Tim Barnes, Hunter McGee, Kristen Larson, Karen Powell, Florence Cooper, and Carrie Allen. Any other birthdays that we want to lift up and celebrate? Yes, Linda. Happy birthday to them. Aaron?
My Arnie's has a birthday today.
Any other birthdays? Yes.
Ronald has a niece who has a birthday this coming week.
Okay. Well, bless it. Oh, yes.
One more name.
It is the week for nieces. I love it. Okay. For anniversaries this week, I have Andy and Allie Leatherman are celebrating an anniversary. Any other anniversaries? I know we're about to come up on like the end of the May jackpot where it's a ton of anniversaries. It's all the teachers. You laugh, wait till May 28th. Just wait. Wait till that Sunday. No other anniversaries? All right, well, blessings for the life and the love shared here in this congregation. I've lost my bulletin. There we go. If you will stand and join me for our centering song, we're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 5 of The Church is One Foundation, hymnal page 545. Thank you. If you'll remain standing and look in your bulletin, we'll have our call to worship. Break forth into singing, you ruins of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. Now, if you'll turn your hymnal to page 881, we'll share together the Apostles' Creed. I invite you to join along. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. If you'll take a moment to turn and share the love of Christ with your neighbor. As we make our way back to our seats, we'll enter into a time of prayer and reflection. I invite you to share out loud any names of those who we need to be in prayer for this day. Bernard. Thank you. Thank you, Bernard. Tammy. Greg.
Prayer of thanksgiving for all y'all that prayed for us last weekend. So it was in the correctional facility. God was great dude. Awesome song. God showed up and showed out.
Thank you for that service. Yes, Sherelle. I've asked for prayers for my grandfather, who's hopefully going to be released from Ochsner today. Anyone else? Yes, Steve. Thank you. Well, God knows all of those that are on our hearts. God knows all of those that are being sent in virtually. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. God, as we come to you on this sunny Sunday morning, and as we can look ahead and see that the weather is going to start warming up inside or outside, we ask, God, that you help keep us mindful of all the good gifts you give us, God. God, especially in light of some of the service that we've heard today, God, we know that our prayers are with those who are incarcerated, those who are repentant of what they have done, God, those who are seeking you no matter where they are. We give you thanks for the bravery of those who have worked and continue to work and put themselves in harm's way, for the well-being of countless people that they do not know, God. We thank you for that service and ask that you keep us mindful of all that has happened, so that we can live the way that we do today. God, for those who are sick and injured, those who are awaiting test results, those who will be undergoing tests this week, God, we ask for a calm spirit. We ask for their medical teams, and we ask for bravery and fortitude, no matter what the news and no matter what the outcome. For the new life, God, that is springing up everywhere around us, that we see in nature, that we see in our families, for the new babies that we hear crying, God, we give you thanks. God, I ask that you be with everyone joining us today, God, those that are here in the pews, those that are watching us virtually, God, put your hand on them this week and help us to not only shine forth your light, but to take time every day to remember whose we are and why we are here, God, and that is to glorify you in all that we do. Thank you for the gift of mind. Thank you for the gift of song. Thank you for all of the ways that you enable us to praise you and how wonderful you are, God. God, we now come together as your people as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. Now it's time for our tithes and offerings. Let's have a word of prayer. Dear Father, we thank you for all the many gifts you bestow upon us. We know that there's not one thing that we have that has not been given. We pray that you would weigh in our hearts to give as we're able, and that we would be good stewards of what you give to us and what we give to this church. In Jesus' name, amen.
John.
If you turn to page 791 in the hymnal, we're going to read Psalm 67 responsively. 791. O God, be gracious to us and bless us and make your face to shine upon us. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth.
Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. God has blessed us. We're now going to sing a hymn that's in your bulletin, It's Eyes on the Sparrow. It's the insert.
Thank you. may be seated. For our scripture today, we're going to read Acts 7, 55 to 60. This is a really interesting part of the book of Acts. And it's worth going and reading a couple of the chapters ahead of time. Basically, the 12 disciples, well, there were 11 left at that point, I guess, because of Judas' suicide. But the disciples got busy serving the needs of the community, and they became overwhelmed with their version of Tuesday morning ministry and needed help. So they decided to recruit some extra people to help. They decided they needed seven extra people. And one of the people they chose was Stephen. And they chose him because of his faith and because of the power of his preaching. And the power of his preaching was such that he really got under the skin of the religious leaders to the point where they decided they needed to shut him up, basically. And in a way that's familiar from what happened with Jesus, they riled up members of the community to claim that he was blasphemous and so on. And they brought him before the authorities, and they decided they needed to stone him. So this scripture, these five verses we're going to read, is at the end of that process after he was appointed to help with the ministries of the new church. So this starts in verse 55. But filled with the Holy Spirit, he gazed into heaven, and he saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. But they covered their ears, and with a loud shout all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him, and the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning Stephen, he prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. And when he had said this, he died. So that's our scripture reading for today. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord God, we thank you for the amazing witness of Stephen, who would not be quieted, for his faith and for his miraculous ability and decision to forgive those even as they were murdering him. I pray that as I speak these next few words, that they would come out in a reasonable order rather than a jumble, that they'd make some sense, and I pray that this would be about the water, not the watering can. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, for me, one of the nice things about, or helpful things about this situation is that, so I'm a psychologist, not a preacher, or a minister, or a theologian, so I can say unorthodox things and just say, oh, sorry, I didn't know, you know. I want to speak a couple of minutes about forgiveness. This is a really difficult topic, but I chose this because in my own walk here at this church, I live in the intersection between faith and spirituality and psychology. I can't leave my professional self behind when I come here, and I can't leave my spiritual self beside when I'm working. And of the four lectionary readings today, this is the one that stood out to me as having the clearest intersection between spirituality and psychology. I spend a lot of time when I'm meeting with people, dealing with issues related to forgiveness, or the difficulty of forgiveness. We prayed a few minutes ago when we said the Lord's Prayer. We affirmed and asked God to forgive us. Why? Because we've forgiven others who've wronged us. So that's a hard
That's a hard message. We just read about Stephen, but a few weeks ago, on Good Friday, we read about Jesus on the cross, who was being killed, assassinated, not assassinated, but murdered at the cross. And what did he say as they were trying to decide who's going to get his clothes, and as his mother is there watching him die, what did he say? Lord, forgive them. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Of course, on one level, they knew exactly what they were doing, right? They were killing him. They knew that. What was it that they didn't know? They didn't know the impact. They didn't know the importance. They didn't know the significance of what they were doing. And I think that's something that's good for us to keep in mind when we contemplate forgiving. We might think on a level that we know what we're doing or what we're trying to do, but we may be doing something much deeper and more important than what it seems to us at the moment. So Jesus did that. Stephen did that. And then what came to mind to me also, some of you may remember this or parts of this. In 1981, Pope John Paul II was shot twice in St. Peter's Square in the Vatican by a man named Mehmet, M-E-H-E-T, Mehmet Agcar, A-G-C-A-R, a Turkish man. Shot him twice. It was part of a bigger plot, and the whole plot didn't get implemented, but he shot him. Pope John Paul II almost died through blood loss. Agcar was arrested immediately. That was in 1981. He was in prison. He was convicted and put in prison in Italy. In 1983, Pope John Paul II went to his prison cell, and there's a very moving picture of the Pope in a folding chair in the prison cell, sort of hunched over, head to head with Agcar. And there's no audio of that. There's picture, and I think there's some video too. There's no audio. We don't know like what words transpired between them, but Pope John Paul forgave him. If not before then, he forgave him at that point. Because that's what he said he'd done. Whether Agcar asked for forgiveness, we don't know. We don't know anything that he said, but we know that Pope John Paul forgave him. I think it's significant that there was two-year period in between, because one of the struggles that we deal with, I think, is that there can be a rush to forgive because we know we're supposed to, but forgiveness is something that takes some time to get to, at least for most of us. It takes some time to get to. There's a quote from this book. I'm going to say a little bit about this book in a minute, that says premature forgiveness is like unripe fruit. Okay? We can rush to it because we think we know we're supposed to do it. It's part of our faith that we do that. But it's a point in a process, sort of like grieving is a process, forgiving is a point in a process. And what we want isn't the form or the shape of forgiveness, we want the substance of forgiveness. And when we don't forgive, we're holding on to things that are toxic to us. Resentments, bitterness, thoughts about retribution, fantasies about retribution, all those kind of things. Keith Tonkel spoke about this from time to time, about not about the cost. Often it doesn't cost the other person anything for us not to forgive them. Sometimes it does, but often it doesn't. It costs us when we hold on to those hot coals and we bury them away inside. So forgiveness is a process. So back to John Paul II. So in 1983, he forgave Agcar. In 2000, so that's 17 years later, he advocated with the Italian government to pardon him and release him from jail, which is what happened. So he became free. He went back to Turkey. He was arrested again for other crimes that he had committed before that, but he was free in
2000. In 2007, he became a Christian, Catholic specifically. So Adhkar converted and became a Christian, 2007. And then 7 years after that, in 2014, and there's a photograph of this too. There's, to me, a moving photograph of Adhkar, who'd now been released from Turkish prison. He was back in Italy. He's dressed in a suit. He's walking across St. Peter's Square, and he's holding 24 white roses that he was bringing to John Paul's grave. It's amazing. So again, to me, this is an example of, you have the form of forgiveness. I forgave this man who tried to kill me, but the substance of it is so much deeper. And this didn't happen overnight. What I just told you happened, what started 1981, it started 2014. I'm not going to try to do the math in my head right now, but it's like 28 years or something like that, this process unfolded. We can be short-sighted. We do something we want to see. Okay, I want to see the results right now. We get used to that, right? Everything like now. But sometimes it takes a while for fruit to become ripe. Okay? I said I want to say something about this book. And actually, well, okay. I need to back. Well, no, I asked not to be in a jumble, so I'm going to hold off on that. Some of you have read this book. This book had a big impact on me. It's called The Sunflower. It's written by Simon Wiesenthal. So some of you may remember that name. Simon Wiesenthal also was known as the Nazi hunter. The first part of the book is autobiographical. He was in a concentration camp that was sort of like a village, and it had a hospital on the grounds. The hospital was treating not people in the concentration camp, it was treating German soldiers. And he was on his work detail, and he got summoned. A nurse came out of the hospital and said, "Come on, you need to come with me." And she dragged him into the hospital up to the bedside of a Nazi SS soldier, officer, who was dying. He had become mortally wounded. He was dying, and he had committed horrendous atrocities in murdering civilian Jews in Russia. And Wiesenthal had been summoned solely because he's a Jew. And what the nurses wanted him to do was to forgive the Nazi officer for having done these atrocities. So the first part of the book is recounts what I just said, basically, and more. And ends with a question rather than an answer. The rest of the book, which is most of the book, are a series of short essays, like 1.5, 2, maybe 3 pages, by a whole group of different people, commenting on, giving their thoughts from their perspectives on the issue of forgiveness, specific forgiveness in general, but Wiesenthal's question at the end was, what should I have done, or did I do the right thing? And they were responding to that. And there's a very wide range of people, but they include the Dalai Lama, Desmond Tutu, Dith Pran, Matthew Fox, Harold Kushner, who wrote Why Do Bad Things Happen to Good People, Primo Levi, who'd been in a concentration camp himself. There's about 40 or so of these essays in here. I'd recommend it, not so much because it gives answers, it actually gives like 50-something answers that are all over the board. But I think sometimes the questions are more important than the answers. So anyway, that's my thought about this. So just to wrap things up and to finish the jumble, I was going to do this at the beginning. So I think all any of you can see is a Ziploc bag. But in the Ziploc bag is a mustard seed. And that's all we're asked to offer. It's a mustard seed of faith. So I gotta say, if you want to if you don't believe that there's really a mustard seed in here, come on up and take a look. It's really in there. Yeah. So I'm gonna leave that there. That's sort of a I guess in a way you can consider that an offering also. Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, and we together thank you for the witness of Jesus, and men like Stephen and John Paul II, and others in this very room who have taken courageous and difficult steps in forgiving others. We pray that you would help us to utilize the faith that we do have, as small as it might be, to undertake things that we might not see the results of now, but maybe over time they can grow into something. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So here's something I get to say because I'm a psychologist, is that we don't get to do communion today because there's not an official person to bless the elements. So I'm sorry about that. I just don't qualify. So I think we're just going to do our benediction song, right? Okay, we'll do that.